I'm here with David at Walsall Ceramics, and he's going to tell us about some of the recent work that he's been doing and some of the things that are particularly exciting. And anyway, here he is. Hi, David.
Hello there.
Sorry. No, it's all right. It's all right. Don't worry. Now everyone's comfortable in front of the camera. So come on, 25 years. Well, you must have seen some changes in certainly the quality of the trees.
Definitely. The trees have got much more refined over the years, and that is certainly reflected on the sort of pots people are looking for. Much more attention is paid to positioning of the feet, the height of the pot, and I think the potters have had to keep pace with the quality of trees to some extent as well.
But you know, the interesting thing that is that the trees have improved, but certainly the pots have improved. You know, with respect to a lot of people years ago, the pots were a bit rough around the edges, weren't they?
Yeah. I mean,
do you think it's because people have become more demanding as well?
Partly. I think a lot of people who came into the bonsai pot industry had come from the trees. There was no bonsai pot industry in Britain, so it's really had to be, I suppose, pioneered over the last 25, 30 years with Gordon Duffy starting it off, really.
It's quite interesting. I mean, everybody cites Gordon, and I'm sorry, listeners, but I have attempted to chat to Gordon, but he's not, he's quite a shy chap. Once you get to know him, he's okay, but he is quite a shy chap. So, who were your influences? How did you suddenly think, yeah, this is for me?
Well, pottery, my dad was a potter, so he taught me. He'd been making pots since the age of 20. He died last year at 81, so I've grown up around pots.
It's in your genes?
It's in the genes, and we had a pottery at the house, so I've always been around clay. He taught me the hand-building techniques that we still use. The glaze was his recipe, although we've adapted it, and he's always been a constant source of, one of the big influences as well. He was never pleased with what he made, and
that's the sign of a true artist.
It is. Everything he made, he would think, oh, that's coming up, or the next one will be better, so I think I learned a good lesson from him with that.
Do you know, it must excite you when you see a really good tree and you think, oh my God, it's in our pot! Wow, I must get a picture of that!
It is nice to, when the two go together, it's absolutely fantastic. Individually they're both good, but sometimes when you get the right combination, it is stunning.
All right, well, let's explore that, the right combination. So let's say, for instance, I've got a cascade, all right, we'll take it from the top. I have a cascade, blackthorn. It's, and what would you recommend for that? Now, bearing in mind it's quite a rugged looking tree, let's forget the size at the moment. What would I have it in? A glazed pot or an unglazed pot? Or?
If the glaze was dark, certainly I quite like colour. If you can get the colour, you get a tonal value that flat pots don't always have, and blackthorn, dark grey colours, greeny grey colours. But again, we're in a very difficult area. It's the person whose tree it is to make that final choice. We always prefer it when people say, that's the colour I want. It's very difficult to make. You can offer advice, but
yeah. Some people are not willing to take it. I know certainly from experience of working with the late, great Derek Aspinall, Derek advised, we discussed about the raft, and we originally put it in a silvery grey pot, and the moment we put it in, we realised it was wrong, and then we opted, that was an oval, and then we opted for a rectangle in a brown. Now, you don't always get it right first time, but certainly there's a lot of choice out there, and I think the variety of pots that you've got on your stand now has got to be 10 times more than you had 10 years ago.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Pottery is a technical skill. The longer you do it, the more you learn, the better you get.
Yeah, you brought a pot with you, haven't you?
Yes.
What do you want to show us, this one?
This is one of the latest pots we've been working on. It's we'd been on a pottery course ourselves to see somebody working in this way.
You went back to school, yeah?
Yeah, every year we'll at least attend one. Once a year we will go and be in the crowd, if you like, and learn some more about pottery, or just watch other potters, studio potters, not bonsai potters, if that work. But this is a very... There's Japanese pots that look like this as well, where they make them in fragmented
pieces.
Well,
let's just take a close look at this, there we go. Okay. Now this is quite interesting, because I know, going back certainly 10 years, nobody would have considered a pot like that for bonsai, would they? It would have either been a flat or a colour and that.
Yeah, I think the other thing that's brought the pots on as well is with display. Now we're starting to look at how the Japanese would display things, that if you like, the pots are abstract landscapes. So, you know, you could even think that that might even represent what's under the ground. It might just be the soil underneath.
It could
be just how it's done, or certainly for fairly rugged things, that is saying a rugged landscape.
Okay, I'm going to be a bit controversial here and say that certainly there is a movement towards Europeans having their own style. Now, personally, I don't sit with that. My take on it is that the trees will evolve in whichever way they want to evolve. I know that when I look at old cockapoo books, I don't particularly like the trees. I like the trees in the newer end of cockapoo books. And I think that the European style doesn't exist. And by that, and the fact that you're introducing certainly Japanese ways into your pots will certainly add more controversy. And I like that's okay.
We're very, very influenced by Japanese pottery, by their good handmade pottery, the Tokuname type things where they're made by the individual potters. That's what we aspire to. The quality of workmanship on, I have to say, big A's pots, just stunning. You pick them up, they're the right weight. They're so well made. They're certainly a big influence. But equally, we were talking about Gordon Duffy when I first started pottery and looked at his pots. They were just stunning. And he might not come and be on interview, but if you look at the pots, pots speak for themselves. I collect bonsai pots as well. I've got Gordon's pots. I've got some by Derek Aspinall, Brian Albright. If I see pots I like, I just have them.
I think one of the things we are blessed with in the UK is we have a wealth of good craft bonsai potters. And have you seen anybody up and coming in Europe? Anybody else that's out there? I'm not saying in particular names, but certainly the Italians have got a particular, you know, Certi. Is that how you pronounce it?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen a lot of theirs. There's some, I think he's a Czechoslovakian guy. I've got quite a few of his pots. They are very...
Isabellian?
Yes. Yeah, I like those pots. But there's a lot of nice pots if you go to the Nalanders show. There's just a wealth of potters there. And a lot of people doing very, very interesting things. And it's just nice to see there's room in the market for everybody to make all sorts of different things.
Okay, well listen, thank you very much indeed for taking your time, David.
My pleasure.
Good luck with the rest of the show.
Thank you.
All right.